So I'll be talking about bird flowers and flower birds. In other words, that is also known as ornithophily. So this is the photograph taken by me, and this bird is known as Lowton's sunbird. And you can see it is taking nectar from some flower. This photograph is there on Wikipedia, and this photograph was used by Mr. P. Kannan on the cover of his book known as Ornithophily, Interdependency Between Plants and Nectar Feeding Birds. And P. Kannan was the second MSc student of Dr. Salim Ali. Salim Ali is the famous ornithologist who worked with BNHS till he died. And this book was published, and when the book was published and the first copy was given to Mr. P. Kannan, he was very old. He died on the same day. So I got a complimentary copy because this photograph is taken by me. That's why the subject is very near to me, and I read this thesis of Mr. Kannan, and then I found out some research papers by Dr. Salim Ali on bird flowers and flower birds, and I decided that I should make a nice presentation on this subject and started taking observations and photographs according to the as per the topic, to explain the topic to the students, because I teach at the Conservation Education Center in Mumbai. So we run courses like the basic course in ornithology and courses in plants and herpetology, other course online hybrid courses. So I wanted to give a talk on that. So I prepared a talk, and that's how this talk is there. I'm happy to present in front of you. So I won't use much complicated terminology, because generally I use the talk to explain science in simple language. So what is the problem? What was the problem? Let us talk about trees. So when long ago, like million years ago, when trees were evolved, they had some problems. The plants had problems, and the problem were like they cannot speak. They cannot speak language like the humans, or cannot communicate like humans. The plants cannot travel. The trees cannot travel. Then they are fixed to the ground. So these were the problems. The trees suffered, and the plants suffered. So they were trying to find out solutions to their problems. So they found a problem, that is they having seeds, and making the seeds very light can make the seeds travel to far off distances. So this is an example from Axillium, a dandelion. And in Vidarbha, we used to call this as Matari or Buddhi. So these seeds travel long distances. And there are other seeds like this seed. You may think that this is a very big seed, but when you hold it horizontally, you can see it's as thin as paper. And you must be familiar with this Armenia species, a plant which is very common in Vidarbha, and this type of seeds, which also you can say they have got wings, so they can fly. So the tree, one of the solutions, though, so a few of the solutions which the trees found were to use air, water, or birds, or mammals, or humans for carrying their seeds. Just like humans, we also, many of us want that their kids should go to far off places like America or Europe for study, and should settle in those countries. So plants must be thinking in the similar way, that their seeds should go to far off distances and their trees should grow there. So they also have found their own solutions. So why somebody like air will carry the seeds? Like in the previous slide, the air is carrying the seeds of this plant. This is parachute, and this small black, this is the seed. Okay, these are the seeds. But the trees also wanted to utilize birds, because birds are everywhere and birds travel long distances. So the trees develop fruits. And the fruits are eaten by birds, because the fruits also have a lot of nutrition in the fruits. Like the hornbill, you can see the Indian grey hornbill feeding on banyan fruits, and the rosy starling feeding on banyan fruits, and coppersmith parrot feeding on cluster fig. So these birds eat the seeds, eat the fruits, and the seeds are not digested. But when they pass through the system, digestive system of these birds, they become more ready to germinate. So the percentage of germination increases. And for this rosy starling is a migratory bird from Europe. Consider that this bird eats the fig fruits in Buldana, and in one day it travels to Delhi. So it is thousands of kilometers. The fig has successfully taken his carried his seeds to a long distance, and helps in dispersal of the next generation of the fig or banyan. You might have seen trees, banyan trees, peepal trees, and gular trees or umber trees growing on old houses or temples. So many of us must have thought how these trees are growing there. So this is nothing but the work done by these birds, frugivorous birds or fruit eating birds, who eat the fruits, but the seeds are not digested and the seeds germinate wherever they excrete the seeds. So this is the excreta of Indian grass, which I collected from a nest, and you can see the tiny, tiny seeds of the figs, the Ficus bengalensis, or the wadu tree, and other tree seeds are also there. So there was a movie known as Avatar, in which they have shown this analogy of these seeds, parachute seeds with parachutes, showing that there can be transfer of genetic material. It can fly from one planet to another planet. And sometimes it may get accepted. That was the analogy behind this scene. But we learned the scene might not have thought about what the director wants to show us. So it is not always possible for the trees to transfer or send the seeds from one place to another place. So what the trees did? So they produced pollen grains, which are very, very tiny. Like you may not be able to see the actual structure of the pollen grains with your naked eyes. So they produced pollen grains and they used various methods of transporting pollen grains from one tree to another tree. This is nothing but, what are pollen grains? Pollen grains are nothing but packets of genetic material. So you can say it is a parcel, or you can say it is a love letter also. So the pollen grains might be transferred, or they may be transported from one place to another using the air or the water or using insects, birds, and other animals. So the first method, but when the tree wants to send the pollen grains from one place to another, the tree has to take a decision. How do I send the pollen grains? Which medium to use? Like there are mediums which I showed, like wind, water, insects, birds, and other animals. So the tree or the plant has to decide which courier company I want to use and how much I need to pay for the courier company so that my pollen grains are transported to the right place where they will be mating with the eggs or of the other tree and germinate, result into the formation of seeds. So the pollen grains, they have various transport mechanisms or courier companies. So, but will they get something as reward? This courier company will always ask for money, and that is known as reward. So how to inform to the agents that there is a reward? So if there is a courier company, like there is a method, like there are birds, how do you tell the birds that there is a parcel you need to carry? And how do you tell them that we will pay you for carrying the parcel of genetic material? So the first example is the transportation of pollen grains by air. So if the tree wants to transport the pollen grains by air, they need to produce millions and millions of pollen grains. Now you can see this looks like dust. But how far these pollen grains will travel? Not far. So it is, they have to produce a lot of pollen grains still if the pollen grains are not going far away. So what happens if they want to transfer the pollen grains by air? So they have to produce enormous number of millions and millions of pollen grains. But pollen grains are light and non-sticky, because they should not stick onto any subject. They should get carried by with the air. And the stamen and feathery should be well exposed, and stigma should be feathery so that they can catch the pollen grains which are flying in the air. So there is one more thing which happens if the pollen grains are to be transported by air. There is no need of colorful flowers. There is no need of nectar, because air don't want any reward, and there is no need of scent. So those flowers will be without scent, without nectar, and might be just white color. Then another is the transportation of pollen grains by insects. But now if insects are around, you need to tell the insects that the pollen grains, you need to carry the insects and we will pay you something. So this flower has got these bright colored petals. So these brightly colored petals will attract the insects, and pollen grains are large and present in small numbers. So the pollen grains stick to the body of the insect. And stigma lies within the petals here. And the flowers may be solitary or as in any inflorescence. So plants or trees decide to attract insects for pollination, generally the color of the flowers is yellow. for example, for the honeybees and for the various types of beetles and even for ants. And you can see the pollen grains here all over the body of this beetle on the Smithia flower or the honeybee. You can see the pollen grains here, and you can see the bag of pollen grains. This orange colored sac is full of pollen grains already. So yellow silk cotton, this is one example which attracts honeybees for the cross pollination because of the yellow color. And the Caesalpinia also attracts insects like the beetles, and Palash, as you know, also attract insects for the cross pollination. But of course, Palash is visited by many species of birds, and we are going to that subject. So this is yellow lantana. So the flowers are just like the other species of lantana camara, in which is there in Vidarbha. You can see the lantana camara also here. So both species of lantana attract a lot of insects for pollination. So there is one more species of our plant that is known as Vidalia. This Vidalia has got this flower, composite flowers like this, just like sunflowers, and they attract a lot of insects including butterflies because of the yellow color. So yellow color is meant for attracting the honeybees and attracting the insects. Then the for diurnal insects. So if the plant or tree has decided that the cross pollination will happen with the insect, with the help of insects, now there are two categories of insects. That is the day flying insects or diurnal, and night flying insects or the nocturnal insects. So for the day flying insects like the honeybees, the flower color will be yellow. And for butterflies, if the plant wants that the butterflies should be cross pollination, the colors should be very, very varied, because butterflies can see the colors very well. They have a compound eyes which are made up of so many lenses, like thousands of lenses. But for nocturnal insects, insect pollinators, and like moths and bats, there is no need of colors, because in the night the moths may not be able to see the colors. But moths and bats, what they have is they have the very powerful sensation of scent. So if the flowers have a good smell or odor, the moths and bats will get attracted. So the color may be white, because white will be more visible in the night rather than having any other color. And the tubular corolla should be tubular for moths, and the flowering happens at night. So this is a butterfly and not a moth. So the photograph is taken with high aperture. That's why the background looks black. So the tubular corolla always attracts butterflies because they have a long proboscis. So the proboscis can reach to the base of the flower where the nectar is located. And if the flowers or plants want insects to have, butterflies to have as pollinators, the compound flowers are always more attractive for them, because compound flowers have got so many small flowers actually, which are known as disflorets, and the ray florets are only for advertisement. So there are so many small flowers that the butterflies spend a lot of time on these flowers, like this, even this lantana and verbena. And the flowers are tubular for this, small and tubular, but not very long. So the colors can be bright, including red and purple. The odor can be there, like faint, but as it has to be the fresh odor and not like stinking or something rotting. So look at these, all these flowers. The flower length is not too long, and the corolla is tubular. 1, 2, 3. Here also, this is coxcomb. Also, the very tiny flowers are here, and then this Mosenda species, and also this Helicteris isoflora. You can see all these flowers have some same characteristics. These are colorful, long, and tubular corolla. All these are the characteristics because of which butterflies get attracted, and they are doing the cross pollination or carrying the pollen grains from one flower to another flower. Then there are some plants or trees which decided that their pollen grains will be transported by other animals. So like this. So if there are other animals, you don't need color. Or if there is color, it's good, because animals can see the color. And not many animal species are there who help in carrying pollen grains. Like there are squirrels which love nectar. So the squirrels are responding. This is a palm squirrel, and there are giant squirrels also feed on. They don't feed on actually for nectar. They eat the entire flowers. They eat the petals also. So they do the cross pollination, but also they damage the flowers. Even there is a species of tree mouse which also feed on nectar. So consider moths as pollinators. So I showed you that their flowers open at night, and that opening is known as anthesis. So the flowers may there is no need of having colorful flowers. The flowers may be pale or dull red or purple or pink. So the one example will come at the end of the presentation. May have strong sweet odor which is emitted at night, because daytime. So there are flowers like Ratrami, which are everybody knows the name, and some more flowers like we have. And moths have very big antenna, like we used to have for the television sets in the olden times, and like comb like antenna. So this antenna is nothing but to capture the scent or odor, not only of the opposite sex but also of the flowers, and to locate where the flowers are so that they can feed on the nectar. So let us turn towards the birds. So if the trees and if the plants want that the birds should do the carry the pollen grains from one place to another, they need to have certain adaptations, and this this carrying or transportation of pollen grains by birds is known as ornithophily. Ornitho means bird and philia means love. So these are the trees which are bird loving trees or bird loving flowers, and the flowers so this is the interaction between flower birds and bird flowers. So that also you can call as ornithophily. Why these trees select birds to transport their pollen grains? Because birds are found everywhere, even at high altitude in the Himalayas. Birds are active during the even during the bad weather, when there is even there is snowfall, you can see some birds feeding around. And even if it is raining or if it is very hot, birds will be still active and feeding on pollen grains. Feeding on nectar. And birds travel long distances, as I have given an example of rosy startling traveling from Buldana to Delhi. So 1,000 kilometers can be easily covered in one day by many species of birds. So that's why the trees want birds as pollinators. But now here in this photograph, you can see the vernal hanging parakeet, and you can see the pollen grains on its chest. It is not the color; it is the entire and even the beak. And this is smeared with pollen grains, and this is Pathodia. And you can see there is a place for the bird to sit on, or that is known as perching. And in India, up to 1997, there were more than 60 species of birds reported which were visiting flowers and feeding on nectar. And more than 93 species of trees or plants were being visited by these, you can say, nectarivorous birds or birds feeding on nectar. So we will just compare how the plant has to adapt, how the tree has to adapt if the tree wants to use birds as pollinators, and if the tree wants to use butterflies as pollinators. So the butterfly, the first thing is the tree has to have flowers which are very big and has got large quantity of nectar if they want to attract birds. So the I have shown here a glass of wine. So you can also consider it as a glass of sweet juice. So if they want to attract birds, they need more quantity of nectar, and a small quantity will not do, except if it is a small bird like a hummingbird, which is not found in India. And the birds need more sugar because the birds are bigger in size, and they need a lot of energy for flying. But then they don't need so much of amino acids, and the plants cannot afford to produce so much sugar. So what they do is they dilute the quality of the nectar, and therefore if you can see, all those flowers are always directed upwards like a glass of nectar, so that the nectar doesn't go waste or fall off, because it is a liquid. And if it is for butterflies, you can see the quantity has to be very, very less. You can see the size of the flower, so tiny flower. So there is just a small drop of nectar at the base of this corolla, and the sugar will be less and amino acids will be more. And the quality, of course, the small quantity of nectar will be very, very thick or very concentrated. I was standing at a tree known as Erythrina, or Pangara in Marathi, and in 1 hour I could photograph these bivalve birds feeding on nectar. Then red-winged bulbul, then came the ashitrungu, then came the purple sunbird, then came the red-breasted bulbul, then the jungle babbler, then the chestnut-tailed starling, and the common-tailed bird. So many birds came in 1 hour. If I stay there, or if I take observations of Erythrina, for 8 days, I'm sure I will get more than 30 species of birds which come to Eritrea to enjoy the nectar, and of course they have been cross-pollinating the flowers. Then there is another flower which is red silk cotton. Everybody knows this as Kateshwar or Shalmali in our area in Maharashtra, and the flowers are very colorful. So this colorful flowers serve as an advertisement to attract the birds. You can see the nectar here, little bit of nectar here. So an hour of observations near the silk cotton tree, I can find house crow. You can see the pollen grains on at the base of his beak. So many pollen grains. Then red-winged bulbul came, bivalves. Then this house crow actually taking the nectar, and so many birds keep coming. So and Spathodia, you can see the vernal hanging parakeet. Again, you can see the perching place for the bird, and the pollen grains on the chest, pollen grains on the entire chest. So the anti-colorful flowers of Spathodia campanula attracting lots of birds. I have seen, my friend has seen 60 species of birds coming to the tree, and many of them were feeding on the nectar. So when the plants decided that their cross-pollination will be done by birds, there has to be some adaptations. For example, the flowers has to be very colorful, red, orange, or purple. And this hummingbird taking nectar from a flower known as firecracker or Russellia, which is now available in India also. So look at the shape of the beak of this bird, and also the shape of the flower and length of the flower or corolla. So the length of the beak and the length of the corolla of the flower is same. That means the bird and the plant evolved together and in the same place. So we don't have hummingbirds in India, but we have the plant because we brought the plants to India for growing in gardens. So the hummingbirds don't have any sense of smell, so there is no use of having any beautiful smell or odor for these flowers. So what are the things which the birds need? Now, I showed you hummingbird, which is not found in India. Now let us look at some birds which are found in India. So these are the hummingbirds, fire-tailed sunbird, crimson sunbird, and purple-rumped sunbird, and purple sunbird visiting various flowers. So then what are the common things in these flowers? The reason behind all these sunbirds visiting these flowers. First thing is it has a long and pendulous flower. The flowers are hanging down, so the birds can hover around a little bit and take the nectar, and look at the shape of the flower and look at the beak shape. So it is matching curved flower and curved beak. Length of the flower is also same. Long, narrow floral tubes. You can see the tubes here. You can see the tubes here. Here it is a compound flower. So the nectar is very easy for these birds to take. So these two things are not applicable. So flowers loosely clustered on flexible stalks. These are the two things here. Loosely clustered on flexible stalks. So the bird can perch either on the branch or on the inflorescence itself and enjoy the nectar. Two more examples. You can see the perching mechanism. So this is the plant has provided this, and all the flowers are directed towards this direction so that the bird can perch here and take it, and not from the bird will not perch here and try to go to the nectar. And this bottle brush also, you can see the tree is always very dense, so the bird will always find. Even if the bird can perch here and get the nectar from each and every flower. Then we have Hamilia patens. Then we have this firecracker plant. You can see just like the hummingbird, we have the sunbird. So this is the purple sunbird female, and it's taking nectar. Now look at the entire beak is gone inside. So the shape of the beak and the shape of the corolla of the flower is same. Here also you can see, so the orange colored flowers are the flowers with nectar, and the red ones are without the nectar. So the birds and butterflies can easily identify where to visit first. And this is a mistletoe, and this you can see the flower tips here. These are nothing but locks, and you can see the ants here. The ants cannot find where the nectar is, so the nectar or nectary is, and so the ants are still moving around. But there is a bird which known as flower pecker, which knows how to get to the nectar, and they break open this and feed on the nectar. And one more example of Sterpilia, you can see the Sterpilia here, and the female of the purple rump sunbird. And you can see all the flowers are directed towards the stem. Whichever, this is not because of gravity, it is because of the stem. I will show you one more photograph, which will yeah, this same photograph, and all the flowers which are open are directed towards the stem, so that the bird can perch on the stem or the stalk and reach out directly. So look again at the shape of the flower and shape of the beak of the sun. The same branch, another bird came, Lotan sunbird came. I clicked within 1 hour, the two species on the same branch or the same tree. And this is the crimson, one more species of sunbird found in the Himalayas. So you can look at the beak again, how it is feeding. So the floral posture, so the positioning of the flower is done in such a way that the sunbirds find it very easy or easy to access the nectar. And the ovules are placed at the base and beyond the nectar, so the sharp beak of the sunbird is not damaging the ovules in any way. That is how the trees or the plants ensure the safety of the ovules, because finally that has to grow into the seeds after the pollination is done. So this is known as the landing platform or perch. These are the perches. Now look at Sterculia. So if this is the branch, all the flowers are directed towards this. Now look, if you are thinking about gravity, look at this branch and look, all these flowers are directed towards this and not towards the gravity. All these flowers are directed towards the branches. So they provide the perching mechanism. So that's how the Sterculia has got its flowers totally modified only for the nectarivorous flowers. So these are nothing but the bird loving flowers or ornithophilous flowers. So let us look at some of the adaptations in birds. So there are birds which are flower loving birds or nectarivorous birds, and these birds preferably feed on nectar and nothing else, but they also eat insects because they need other things like proteins and other things. That's why they feed on little bit of insects, but major diet is the nectar. So these are the sunbirds. You look at the beak now, look at the hummingbird's beak, the flower picker, the Chloropsis or leaf bird, and the white eye, all are majorly nectarivorous birds. These are like as good as 100%. You can say more than 90% of the diet includes nectar. So these hummingbirds are found in the America, North America and South America, and they evolved just like the sunbirds in Asia. And this is an excellent example of similar evolution, which is known as convergent evolution. When Linnaeus did some study, he studied many species of hummingbirds and many species of flowers. He found that these five species of hummingbirds evolved with these five species of flowers, and their beaks are exactly matching to the shape of the corolla of these flowers. And these hummingbirds are found on five islands, and these five flowers are found on those same five islands and nowhere else on the earth. That is the interesting thing. So that means the flowers of these five species of plants and the five species of hummingbirds evolved along with the trees. We also have one more species of bird known as spider hunter. So the name of the bird is spider hunter because it feeds on spiders. Also, look at the beak. So the beak is very long and strong and very sharp. That means it wants only long flowers like the banana. So you might have seen banana inflorescence. This has got very long flowers, and these spider hunters feed on those, on the nectar. Now you can see the pollen grains here on its beak. So I have spoken about nectarivorous birds in Americas. This is the hummingbirds, and in our area, that's Asia and South Asia, the sunbirds. So this is an example, excellent example of convergent evolution. So look at this advertisement, and what is the most important word which catches your attention? So the most important word here, which catches my attention, or if my wife is with me, she will look at the word free. Is anything free in the world? I don't believe. There is nothing free in this world, but the advertisement says the Wi-Fi is free, and we don't look at this star which we call as asterisk. That means conditions apply. So this is a forest, and this is summer, and the summer you can see that a lot of trees has gone brown. They have shed their leaves, but there are a few trees which are very colorful, and they are trying to say something. They are advertising something. So they are saying free, free, free nectar. Free nectar for the birds. free nectar for the birds, but is it free in nature? Of course, you know that nothing is free, and the tree produce, and this tree produce colorful flowers because they wanted to advertise something that they are giving something free, so that they attract the customers. And who are the customers? The customers are nothing but the birds and the animals which are helping in the cross pollination. But are they telling that we are giving you some work to carry the pollen grains? No, but they are saying that we will give you something. That's the reward for carrying the pollen grains. And trees produced nectar. So trees spend a lot of energy. I will say the entire energy in summer is spent only on producing colorful flowers, nectar, and pollen grains. And the trees entirely stop producing leaves only because they want to give their maximum attention for reproduction. So when the birds arrive, they can see the colorful flowers, and this is nothing but Deilonyx regia or Gulmohar tree. Now that it has got, now we are very near to the tree, and we know that there are colorful flowers, and the birds also see it from far off distance when they are flying high in the sky, and they get attracted. So what are the adaptations the trees did to attract their own customers? Like they have insects, they have mammals, birds, and how do they attract? So what are the adaptations, or what are the traits they developed to attract various species for cross pollination? Consider that we just look at the color of the flowers. Just look at, consider the flower as a trait to attract various species. How the trees decided who will be my cross pollinator? For example, if the tree wants that the bat should be my cross pollinator, if there is no need of good color, so can be dull white, green, or purple. But if the tree wants that the birds should be my cross pollinator, the color has to be very bright. Like I just showed you the last slide, scarlet, orange, red, or white. You can see the palash, katesaur, all those trees. If the tree wants that their cross pollinator should be butterflies, again the bright colors including red and purple. But if they want that the cross pollinator should be moths, there is again no need of color. So the flowers can be pale or dull pink or white. So this is just about color. Now just look at one more thing, another aspect. Sorry. So the flower shape. Just look at the flower shape. So if the tree wants that the bat should be the pollinators, it has to be bowl shaped, or and it has to be closed during the day. The flower has to open in the night time. If they want the bird should be the cross pollinators, then the flower has to be large, funnel like or cup like, and should have a strong perching support, which we have seen so many flowers with good perches. And if they want that the butterflies should be the cross pollinators, the flowers has to be narrow tubular with spur and wide landing pan, or without pan. If it is without pan, different species of butterflies will visit. Same thing will be for moths, tubular flowers without leaf. And smell or odor. If the flower wants that bat should get attracted, the flower should have good, powerful smell or odor like musty, and it should be emitted at night because bats fly in the nighttime. There is no need the flower, if the flower is open or smell, really smell in the daytime, the bats has no use. If they also want to attract moths, again, they need strong, sweet odor. But for birds, there is no use of having any odor, okay? And there are other things which can be there, like butterflies. Odor can be there. If it is their faint odor, it's okay. But they really don't need. And if they want to attract flies, it has to be rotten or putrid smell. Okay, we think that there is mutualism in the forest, like symbiosis. There is give and take. Both the flowers also benefit, as well as the agents which carry the pollen grains also benefit. That is how we think, but that's not true. It doesn't happen always. So when there is a mismatch of floral adaptations and the adaptations in birds, like the now that the trees have decided who will be my cross pollinating agent. And there are birds which are nectarivorous birds, and they feed on, they help each other. So is it true? But in nature, there are lots of species of birds and there are lots of species of trees and plants. So there is a mismatch and something happens. That is known as nectar robbery or nectar stealing behavior. And that is the most interesting thing. Now look at this sunbird. Now this flower has decided that the cross pollination should be done by butterflies and insects. But now this sunbird, this is purple sunbird female. Purple drum sunbird female. It realizes that there is nectar, but it cannot access it from the front side or the legitimate way of getting to the nectar. So what the sunbird does, because it is intelligent, it just makes a hole at the base of the corolla and sips the nectar without carrying the pollen grains. So the sunbird did not pay, but stole the nectar. This is known as nectar robbery or nectar stealing behavior. And now the small insect also. So if the insect tries to enter from here, you look at the length of the insect. So the entire insect will need to go inside, and might be the corolla will be torn away. So the insect makes a small hole here and enjoys the nectar without doing the cross pollination, because the stigma and all the sex organs are here. So I took this photograph in Mumbai in the Conservation Education Center area. This is Tegetarpeda, and this is highly enlarged photograph, and you can see this insect making a hole at the base of the corolla and enjoying the nectar. And this is in our butterfly garden. And again, the purple sunbird male, eclipse form. This flower is totally adapted for nectarious birds, because it is such a big flower, and it is just like a glass of wine or juice, and the bird can perch on the top. But the sunbird don't want the legal way; it want the illegal way. Now it's making the hole near the base of the calyx here, through this thick calyx, and enjoying the nectar which is there inside. So it is piercing through the red silk cotton, and the red silk cotton, what has happened to it? It has totally lost the benefit of getting a cross pollinator. Now these are beaks of hummingbirds, but we don't have hummingbirds in India. But beaks of sunbirds are also similar to this, and the first thing is they have very sharp tips long, so they can make holes. Second thing is they have got sharp cutting edges. These are known as tomia, and the tomia has got serrations. So these serrations, that they just cut the flower and easily their beak can penetrate inside the flower through the thick calyx or through the corolla and steal the nectar without carrying the pollen grains. So these are the shapes of these nectarious birds. So these are four different types of nectarious birds, but this is a woodpecker. Actually, the beak is not adapted for eating nectar or feeding on nectar, but it is for feeding on insects which are hiding under the bark of a tree. So these are the three. You can see there. It's like they are branched, either bifurcated or with so many small, branching, so that they can sip maximum nectar in a very short span of time. So this is flower pickers, one A, and this is the sunbirds, and again this is also other species of sunbirds. Okay, these are three types of sunbirds, and we will see how it looks in hummingbirds. And these lancet shape looks like a weapon, the woodpeckers, because they push their tongue under the bark of a tree and come out with termites. So that's why they have this type of serrations or branching. So let us see a small video. I hope the audio also will be audible to you. If it's not audible, please let me know. So hummingbirds, can you hear? If you can't hear, just comment. That's the term.
Yes, sir. Hello. Yes, sir. No, yes, sound nahi aa raha, sir. Sound nahi,
sir.
Sorry, the computer hanged a little bit. Okay, that was a video of the hummingbirds, and you saw how the hummingbird uses its tongue to reach to the nectar, and how the tongue is bifurcated like the snake of a tongue, but it is very thin, even thinner than the cord which we use for sewing clothes in our area. So you have seen, and that was, I think, at least the video which was in slow motion, 1,000 times slower than the actual speed with which it happens. So the video is taken by Nat Geo, and was only to show you how it how they take nectar. We have sunbirds with the feeding mechanism very similar, but they are slightly slower than the hummingbirds. So these are few flowers of Argyria, and you can see these holes here because the sunbirds which we have in our area in India, in Maharashtra, their beak cannot reach from here to here because the nectar is here. So what they do is they make holes. And these are the flowers. I have taken this picture in Amravati. You can see this flower. These are tachoma flowers. This is a decorative plant. You can see these holes. So these are the holes made by sunbirds. You can see now the color, yellow color. Yellow color means the tree wants that the cross pollination should be done by insects, especially the ants. But the sunbirds realize that there is a lot of nectar inside. So the sunbirds just make holes here and steal the nectar from these flowers, tachoma flowers. The red silk bottom. Okay, I have shown you one photograph of sunbird robbing. Now you can see here the holes. You can see the holes here, the damage near to the calyx here. These are the scratches or damage done to the calyx here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Done by sunbirds, and the flowers are broken into pieces by squirrels, because thus they not only do the cross pollination, they damage those flowers. And you can see this canna flowers, or kardali we call in Marathi. You can see this hole here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and here and here. So these are the holes done by sunbirds, because the flowers are very big. Everybody is familiar with these flowers in Maharashtra, because these are garden flowers, and people grow in houses also, in backyards. So the sunbird cannot reach from here to the nectar, which is situated here. So they just make a hole and enjoy the nectar without doing the cross pollination. So this is the hibiscus, one species of hibiscus, and you see now how the birds are damaged. So they not only made holes, they damaged the calyx, and they damaged the corolla also. It took the nectar away, and we see a small video which I have taken, only few seconds. Okay, this bird was oriental white eye, and it was stealing nectar from hibiscus species. I have taken this video near Kandala. So now, do you think that the trees do not understand, the plants do not understand there is nectar stealing happening? The nectar stealing birds or the nectar robbers are not only stealing the nectar, they are also damaging the flowers, and that is resulting into a total loss. If like you go to Big Bazaar, and there is so much of crowd in Big Bazaar, just like there are some hundreds of birds on a coral tree, you can say this Katesavar tree, and few are stealing. So if there is one person stealing from Big Bazaar, they at the entrance, at the gate, they have a buzzer. As soon as somebody tries to escape without paying the bill, their buzzer goes on, and they can catch the thief. So the flowers also know that there's something is happening. The birds are trying to steal the nectar, and now they have developed responses. So they, and these are known as defenses or responses to stop the nectar robbery. So there are four types of responses. So first response is to produce toxins and secondary compounds. So those species, non-target species, which they don't want to come and eat the nectar, are inhibited or prohibited. Then escape in time or space. So the plants or trees thought, when is my nectar pollinator coming? Is it coming in the daytime, or is it coming in the morning or afternoon or evening or in the night? So the nectar will be produced only in that time. Then physical barriers like having calyx, big huge calyx, create indirect defenses. Okay, we will see some of them. Like these are two flowers, Datura and then Brugmansia species. Now you look at the calyx. So the calyx is very long, and I suppose the calyx or the plant, the entire plant is poisonous. Now the nectar is here at the base of the flower. I hope you can see my cursor. And everybody is familiar with Datura flowers in Maharashtra. They always say, "What do you, kisi ko konala jar kai milala nahi tar tula kai milala re tar te mhanta Datura." So the flowers are trying to get nectar, but what they get? Datura. They don't get anything. So there is a saying in Maharashtra. So these flowers are white in color. That means they don't want to attract birds. So they are attracting insects like ants for cross pollination. So because of this development of calyx, and you here also you see in this Brugmansia species, Brugmansia. So the birds can't penetrate because this must be poisonous. So they have got compounds which deter the nectar thieves. Now they have same example of hibiscus. See this calyx, and this is also very bad tasting. But there are some birds which, like the we have seen the video, they don't mind and they just still break it. And but that was a different species of hibiscus. This is a different species of hibiscus. So who is the legitimate pollinator for hibiscus? The butterflies. So the other idea is to make physical barriers. Now. Oh, the idea was to bring all the flowers together and form it into a composite flower like the sunbird. Now there is no scope for any bird to make penetrate from here, because this part, the compound flower, this calyx is so huge. Now no bird has any daring or want to spend so much energy in breaking it from here and reach to the nectar. So the birds have only one choice: either you take nectar from here, which is legal or a legitimate way, or just get lost. Now who is the pollinator for the sunflower? So these are known as ray florets, the yellow one, which are brightly colored. These are nothing but advertisements put up by the sunflower, and these are the disc florets, are the real flowers which are packed, tightly packed, and now protecting the nectar very well. So the honey, only insect which comes to collect the nectar and the pollen grains is the honeybees. So if you want more honeybees to your farm, ensure that you don't use insecticide. So now you can see the honeybee is entirely smeared with pollen grains on its body here, and these are known as pollen bags or pollen sacks. So they fill up the pollen bags and pollen sacks and take it back and also feed on the nectar. So what do they do with the pollen grains? So they make the bread or the of the honeycomb. So they make the comb with the pollen grains. So that is used for making pollen. Pollens are used for making the honeycomb and pollen. And nectar is used for feeding themselves and the babies. So producing toxins and secondary compounds. There are examples that low sugar concentration in nectar may also deter nectar robbers, because if there is not much nectar or if it is dilute, it won't yield much energy or profits for robbers. For example, cutty sour or this red silk cotton, no butterflies will come because the nectar is very dilute. Only birds will come because birds can drink lot of nectar and still get good amount of energy from red silk cotton flowers. And there is a plant known as Catalpa which produces nectar containing certain glycosides which are very deterrent to nectar loving nectar stealing ants. But they are good for bee pollinators, bees. So the bees are not bothered about these glycosides. They love the glycosides. So this is a simple mechanism used by this plant. Then escaping in time is just I just said producing nectar according to the arrival time of the legitimate pollinator. So this is effective if robbers and pollinators are feeding at different times. And there is one mechanism as have the flowering only for one day in a year, as in karma flower or Dillenia pentagona. I will show you in next slide. So plant avoids being robbed by growing in a certain location, like next to a plant which is more attractive to the robbers. So they will grow near a plant which has got more beautiful flowers. So all the robbers will go to that flower, like this tree. This is known as Dillenia pentagona or karma in Marathi. and we have two trees very near to my center, and flowering takes place on only one day, early morning, and only honeybees come. You can see the color, and they also have smell. So the smell and the yellow color attracts thousands of honeybees to this tree, and cross pollination takes place. And by the afternoon, all the flowers, all the petals fall down, and the flowers are, the cross pollination is finished. But this year, what happened? The monkeys realized there was a troop of monkeys, and they ate, I think, more than 50% of the flowers. So the mechanism. Last year there were no monkeys, only honeybees were there, and I was there to observe the beautiful flowering and the beautiful cross pollination phenomena happen only up to afternoon, only one day in a year. I will give you one very nice example. You might be thinking, why this Madhumaldi or Kiskialis indica has got flowers in different colors, but it's not like that. Just look at now this example, beautiful study done by some scientists. So the petals are pink, white and red. So what happens in the night time when it is 7 to 8 p.m. the flowers are white with a round corolla and has a delicate scent. Plus there is nectar. Nectar is secreted in huge quantity. So who comes at this time? At this time first comes the bees when the flowers open. And after 8 o'clock what happens? The hawk moths start coming. So this is the hawk moth. Okay, and this is the honeybee. So when the flower opens, first is the honeybee, because after 8 p.m. this night time, so honeybees go to roost or sleep, and then start coming nectar. So the entire time of the moths are around those flowers, and they are enjoying the nectar, and they are doing the cross pollination. What happens after the night is over, that is 8 a.m. in the morning, the flowers turn, become pink in color as soon as the sun rises, and by the afternoon they become dark pink. And there is very little nectar. That means those insects which come in the morning, some of the insects will enjoy it, but not many butterflies will come. Also, the length of the corolla is so long that butterflies cannot reach to the nectar, which is at the base of the flower. What happens in the afternoon at 2 p.m.? The flowers become totally red, and there is no nectar. It stops secreting nectar. That means that these birds want only these hawk moths, which have got very long proboscis, to come and feed on their nectar and to do the cross pollination, and no other species. So this is nothing but an example of escaping in time. When Carl Linnaeus came to saw these flowers, he wrote in his book 300 years ago that there must be a species of moth which is having a long proboscis which can reach out to the nectar in these Madhumaldi flowers, but he could not find moth. That species of moth at that time, but later on, of course, we know there are many species of moths which have got very, very long proboscis. So this is an excellent example. Now the legitimate pollinators. Now the pollinators, they also know that I am the right pollinator, and I should get the right right over the nectar. So for example, bumblebees and honeybee, nectar feeding birds, they can find out which flower already the nectar has been robbed and already the nectar has been eaten. So they avoid these flowers. So they, if the flower is heavily robbed, means already there are holes made at the calyx and in the base of the corolla, these bumblebees and honeybees and nectar feeding insects avoid these flowers. That might be they observe the damage on the petal tissue which is done by the birds, and especially the birds can damage the reproductive parts of the flower, like the ovules. There is one new mechanism which the flowers are using, but we were not aware. Now with technology, human scientists have found out that there is one more mechanism how the flowers respond to pollinators, the presence of the pollinators in the area. So if the flower wants that the bats should not eat my nectar, and when the bats come, the frequency is 35 kilohertz, the flowers will not give any response. The honeybee, this particular type of insect comes, which has got a different frequency, no response. If there is a honeybee which has got only 1 kilohertz frequency, the flowers, yes, they start giving response and they release the nectar. So no nectar if the nectar robbers are around. So these are nectar robbers, and this is the legitimate pollinator for which the tree has decided. So the tree won't release nectar if there is any other species of animal I am. So they just want that particular frequency. So that's all about my presentation. I want to stop here. And the subject is very big and not much research has been done. All the research has been done outside India except Dr. Salim Ali's paper on bird flowers and flower birds. And then Mr. Kannan's thesis on ornithophily, which the cover of which I showed you. Not many research papers could be found in Indian context, and the study of relationship between flowers and birds and insects and flowers is really a total vacuum in Indian perspective. And I hope there are many students who are watching this seminar live, and they get inspiration to do work on this aspect of cross-pollination and so many aspects which I tried to just give an insight into. And this was not, I won't say, I tried to make the presentation very simple by giving simple examples, but that can be made into complicated presentation, which I wanted to avoid. So I hope the presentation was good, and I stop here and over to ma'am. MK ma'am, thanks for inviting me.